This week on Jerusalem Dateline, Palestinian extremists and Israeli security forces clash in Jerusalem. We go straight into the middle of a battle over the Temple Mount. Plus, the miracle of the Kurds, they're friends of Israel and America, and they're the main force standing in the way of ISIS, and protecting the persecuted Christians of the Middle East. What can we do to keep Christianity from disappearing from its birthplace? Hello and welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell. Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas called Israel's closure of the Temple Mount to visitors a declaration of war. Israel closed the area following the assassination attempt of a top advocate for Jewish prayer on the contested compound. Israeli police clashed with Palestinian rioters after Israeli security killed the suspected shooter. Yehuda Glick just finished a lecture at the Begin Center in central Jerusalem as part of an event entitled Israel Returns to the Temple Mount.
From what we know, is part of the ongoing investigation, the assassination was planned ahead of time.
The assassin apparently identified Glick before shooting him at close range and escaping on a motorcycle. Glick is a leading advocate of more Jewish access to the Temple Mount and for the right of Jews to pray there. It's the place where two successive Jewish temples sat. The second was destroyed in 70 AD by the Romans.
It's a result of the Israeli policy that not let Jews pray on the Temple Mount, a policy that sends a signal to the Arabs that they can continue attack in many ways those Jews who wants to go to the most holiest place, to Judaism on earth, to the Temple Mount and pray.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says there'll be no change of the status quo on the Temple Mount. Only Muslims are allowed to pray there, known in Arabic as the Noble Sanctuary. The site currently hosts the Al-Aqsa Mosque and Golden Dome of the Rock Shrine. The incident is the latest in growing violence surrounding the Temple Mount. Israeli officials accuse Palestinian leaders of incitement to violence over the site, including Palestinian Authority Chairman Mahmoud Abbas, who called on Palestinians to use all means to prevent Jews from entering the compound. The Temple Mount is home to one of the most famous mosques in the world. Some Muslims go ballistic whenever rumors spread about Jews threatening that mosque, even if those reports aren't true. It's one of the most holy and contested pieces of real estate on earth, the Temple Mount. For decades, Islamic leaders have incited Muslims to violence by telling them that the Al-Aqsa Mosque is in danger. First, they claim that the Israelis were undermining its foundations to make it collapse. Now they also say it's a threat even for Jews to pray on the sacred plateau.
Extreme movements believe that Israel is planning to build the third temple and to destroy their holy shrine.
Known in Arabic as the Haram al-Sharif, or Noble Sanctuary, it's the place where two consecutive Jewish temples once stood. The second was destroyed in 70 AD by the Romans. Now, Muslim mosques occupy the site. The Golden Dome of the Rock to my right is the most identifiable Muslim shrine on the Temple Mount. But it's the gray-domed Al-Aqsa Mosque to my left that Muslims consider the third holiest site in Islam. They believe that Muhammad took a famous night ride from Mecca to Al-Aqsa on his winged horse, Al-Barak. Al-Aqsa was first built in 705 AD. In Muslim theology, the site precedes the Jews and goes back to creation.
You know, Adam, when he descended from the heaven, he came here and he was pray here.
No different between Sulaiman and King David and all the prophets, it's all the same. They've all been in Al-Aqsa Mosque.
Today, the entire plateau is referred to as Al-Aqsa. Nadav Shragai wrote the Al-Aqsa is in danger libel, The History of a Lie. He says when Muslim leaders want to unite the masses, they claim it's in danger.
The match that ignites the people and brings them to the streets and causes violence is this libel. Al-Aqsa is in danger and this is baseless.
Archaeologist Dr. Gabriel Barkai says there have been excavations near the Temple Mount, but never under it.
One of the cornerstones of Western civilization was never touched by the spade of the archaeologists.
Barkai says it was Muslims, not Jews, who began digging in an attempt to rewrite history.
Since the 90s, there were many destructive diggings going on in the Temple Mount, which were not for archaeological purposes, but the contrary, for destroying archaeological data.
Around 2000, the Islamic religious authorities dug up thousands of years of history with bulldozers from under the Temple Mount to make room for a giant mosque. Barkai headed an operation to save artifacts from the discarded material. Years later, archaeologists and volunteers still sift through the debris. According to Shragai, then Grand Mufti of Jerusalem, Hajj Amin al-Husseini started the libel against Israel in the 1930s. He accused the Jews of wanting to collapse the mosques on the Temple Mount. That led to Muslim rioting and murder of the Jews, just the first of many incidents. Islamic expert Dr. Yitzhak Reiter says the tactic hasn't lost its potency.
They really believe in what they think, that Al-Aqsa is in danger as long as Israel is controlling the eastern part of East Jerusalem.
In 1969, the Muslim world blamed Israel for the arson attack on the Al-Aqsa Mosque by a visiting Australian Christian. That lie continues today. More trouble in 1996. The worst Israeli-Palestinian violence in 30 years broke out when Israel opened an exit for visitors to the Western Wall tunnels half a mile from Al-Aqsa. And in 2004, rain, snow, and a minor earthquake toppled the entrance ramp to the Temple Mount. That provoked an international Islamic uproar when Israel tried to rebuild it. We asked Muslims in Jerusalem what they think.
It's in danger to destroy them, to take the place. It's in danger.
They are digging underneath it and digging and digging, and they don't find anything.
God will save it.
Recently, Israel arrested a key Islamic figure for incitement. He told his followers Israel planned to break into the Temple Mount and they should use their bodies to prevent Jews from going up there. Experts say it's important the West takes notice now because millions of Muslims believe the lie is true. They say if it brought violence in the past, it will do so in the future. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is on the defensive, saying he's under fire because he won't compromise the safety of his country. Those were his first public remarks after an interview quoted a senior Obama administration official calling Netanyahu a word that starts with chicken. The official told The Atlantic the good thing about Netanyahu was that he was scared to launch wars, but the bad thing was he won't reach an accommodation with the Palestinians or Sunni Arab states. Another senior White House official said Netanyahu is a coward on a nuclear Iran and won't launch a preemptive strike. Israel-U.S. relations have plummeted to new lows under the Obama administration. While the president is not on the ballot in the U.S. midterm elections, many say his policies are, and that could hurt the Democrats. We spoke with American voters headed to the polls in Jerusalem. I Vote Israel is a group that encourages Americans living here to register and vote in U.S. elections.
We've helped them, inform them how to fill out their ballot. We haven't chosen the candidates for them. That's their business. But on the other hand, we're here to lend a hand and make sure that they participate in the election.
Americans in Israel have a unique vantage point, living in a Western-style nation in the Middle East surrounded by enemies, something the United States often doesn't understand. We ask Americans here why they're voting and what's important to them.
First of all, I care about America, and second of all, I think that the elections are going to not only influence American citizens, but also the entire world.
Israel's security is important, the threat of a nuclear Iran and the more proximate threats, but I also care deeply about what is happening in the United States. So when I vote with the interests of both countries at heart.
One of the most important things is to get a balanced government in the United States, to not have Obama calling all the shots.
The greatest concern is the faltering relationship between America and Israel.
Some say those relations are faltering because President Obama doesn't understand the Middle East or history.
He's been very naive thus far. He's been demanding concessions from Israel time after time and not demanding anything, not receiving anything in return from the Palestinians.
We have been a true and trusted friend, ally to the United States. And we have been true blue, we've been trusted, we've held back our fire.
This is not about anti-Israel. This is not about Israel. This is about anti-Semitism.
I've made the joke many times that Obama never had any experience with foreign policy, so he had the CIA send him a list of the countries in the world in order of how friendly they are to the United States, and then he hung it on the wall backwards by accident.
And does God figure into the equation in the Middle East?
I absolutely believe that he does figure, and I think faith, certainly for Jews, but also for Christians, is really important, you know, all of the challenges that we are facing today.
Coming up, the Kurds are on the front lines in the fight against ISIS. So why does the rest of the Middle East hate them? Stephen Mansfield has the answer. Welcome back to Jerusalem Dateline. They are a people without a country. And now the Kurds are facing a vicious assault from the terrorists of ISIS. Is the United States doing enough to help them? Gary Lane has a look at the crisis facing the Kurds and the history of these remarkable people.
The ancient people known as the Kurds are scattered throughout the Middle East. They've suffered extreme persecution over the centuries, including a poison gas attack launched against them by Saddam Hussein in March 1988. 12,000 Kurds died an agonizing death. They now control this region in northeastern Syria, and Iraqi Kurdistan has welcomed Christians fleeing ISIS atrocities. Kurds long for a country they can call their own.
This is a dream of every Kurdish citizen. Every ethnic and every nationality have a right to have their own independent state.
A referendum on independence could soon be voted on by Iraqi Kurds, but Iran and Turkey oppose the creation of a Kurdish country. The Kurdish Workers' Party has fought Turkey for the past 30 years. Turkey views the Kurds as a greater threat than the Islamic State jihadists. Instead of fighting ISIS, the Turkish Air Force recently bombed Kurdish fighters near the border.
The Turks are acting with the slogan, "The enemy of my enemy is my friend." So ISIS is now, in that case, a friend of Turkey.
And that further complicates U.S. efforts to stop ISIS. In the book, The Miracle of the Kurds, best-selling author Stephen Mansfield explains why the Kurds need Western support and how a Kurdish nation could serve as a model for the future of the Middle East.
Earlier, Gary spoke with Stephen Mansfield in our U.S. newsroom about the Kurdish people and why he wrote the book.
Most Americans don't even know Kurds.
No, they don't.
What can you tell us about
In fact, them? I've had some funny moments where I've said I'm going to talk about Kurds and somebody will say, you mean the breakfast food? Yeah, I'm really delighted that the Kurds have come to the forefront of our news cycle and of our times. Because they're pretty amazing people. They consider themselves descendants of the ancient Medes, so we're actually reading about their ancestors in our Bibles. They were denied nationhood after World War I, and now after Saddam's atrocities against them, finally the West began to pay attention. And look at the timing. Now they're on the forefront against ISIS, one of the most vicious enemies civilizations known.
Why don't people like them? What's the problem?
Well, people do now, but throughout their history, they really have been horribly treated. You know, they were after World War I, they were promised their own nation. President Wilson's 14 points promising autonomy for local people groups. It was denied through some treaties that were agreed to secretly in Europe. Then they were mistreated by the Iraqi monarchy and then by Saddam, of course. And so they say, we have no friends but the mountains. We are a people without friends. I think that's changing, and I'm glad for my Kurdish friends that that's the case.
They have Syrian Kurds, they have Iraqis, Yazidis, Christians as well,
yes,
flooding into Kurdistan. They're welcoming them. How are they being treated, especially the Christians there?
Well, when the Christians were fleeing other Middle Eastern countries over the last years in this Christian flight that we're hearing about, many of them fled to Kurdistan. In fact, the Kurdish regional president, Masoud Barzani, actually received an award from the Pope. So many of these refugees have fled into Kurdistan because it's the best governed, most peaceful, most fair place. And this brings us to an important point, and that is that the Kurds are very unusual in terms of the Middle East. They are pro-West, they are pro-democracy, they are largely pro-Israel.
Their Islam is different?
Their Islam is far more moderate. They have a Christian department in their government. They have a Yazidi department. department in their government. Women sit on their Supreme Court. Women command troops in the Peshmerga, their word for their army. This is a moderate version of Islam, exactly what the United States should want to encourage.
Things turning a little bit here. What more needs to be done to stop ISIS near the border there?
Well, we've got to arm the Kurds directly, and that's something that the administration has been very hesitant to do. U.S. foreign policy has been based on the idea that we wanted a unified Iraq, so we wouldn't deal with the Kurds directly.
Not going to happen, is it?
It's just not going to happen. Baghdad is relatively corrupt, as we know, and the military pretty much abandoned the field when they came up against ISIS. But the Kurds stood solid, and now the administration has decided to provision the Kurds and to arm the Kurds, and we're seeing a dramatic change. We're also seeing a dramatic change in Turkish policy towards the Kurds. So things are going in the right way just at the beginning, and it's only because I think the U.S. has shown some strength.
And some of the Kurds are coming to faith in Christ. Tell me a little bit about that, and how can we as Christians in America pray for them?
Well, we need to pray for them because they have been abused by their own Muslim brothers. Saddam wrapped himself in Islam to oppose and to destroy the Kurds, to commit his atrocities against them. There have been many, many valiant missionaries and ministers over there, and many Kurds are coming to Christ, and it's because that now there's a free marketplace of ideas, a free marketplace of religion. They're hearing who Jesus is. They're seeing that Christians have been some of the people most caring about them and most supportive of them. And so as a result, we're seeing a great harvest there.
Okay, very good. It's an excellent read. I've read it myself. The Miracle of the Kurds. Thank you, Stephen Mansfield, for being with us.
Great to be with you. Thank you.
Up next, throughout the Middle East, Christians are being forced from their homes at the risk of death. How can we support the persecuted church? Sunday, November 2nd, marks the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. Recently, I sat down in our Washington, D.C. studio with Nina Shea of the Hudson Institute to talk about the rise of Christian persecution in the Middle East.
Well, Nina, thanks for being with us. It's great to see you again.
Great to see you, Chris. Yeah. Thank you.
How would you describe the situation for the Christians, particularly after ISIS has gone through many parts of northern Iraq?
Chris, I used to use the word persecuted, that this was religious persecution. I've stopped using it and started using religious cleansing, because that's what it is now. It's a crime against humanity. It's the eradication of the entire Christian presence in this part of the world, where there has been a Christian presence for 2,000 years. So it's a forcible conversion policy, forcing everybody else out. It's punitive. It wants to see them perish. Preferably from the face of the earth, but to the extent that they're able to drive them out into the desert, they are doing so, depriving them of water, capturing some of the women and girls and enslaving them, killing anybody who resists, stripping them of all their property and their identity papers. So they're really left with absolutely nothing, including not a future either.
So what can be done as a matter of foreign policy from the United States point of view to help combat this?
Well, one of the things that has been bothering me a lot is the fact that the Iraqi government, whom we're supporting now militarily with airstrikes, with training, with equipment, with high-tech arms and intelligence, is doing nothing for their own people who are Christian. And very few people know that when Mosul fell on June 10th, and the minorities were driven out, not just the Christians, but there were a Shiite community as well, ethnic Shiites, the Turkmen, the Shabak Shiites, they were also driven out. The government of Baghdad, the Iraqi government, came in and rescued those Shiites, but did nothing for the Christians.
Do you hope that the U.S. government will speak more forcefully and more about the situation?
Yes, I don't understand why the Obama administration has not spoken up about this. We should be absolutely insisting, as a condition of our aid, that they help the Christians. Winter is coming now. There are tens of thousands of people who don't have a roof over their head, who have no heat, who barely have anything. They've totally mendicant at this point. They've been living in schools up to now, some of them in parks, under highway underpasses even, and they are given nothing. And I also include the Yazidi population as well, which is another minority.
What about the churches here in the West, whether it's the United States or Europe? Should there be more Christian leaders speaking out about the situation?
You know, Chris, Jewish leaders like Ronald Lauder and the World Jewish Congress has spoken up, and I don't understand why our Christian leaders aren't speaking more. There was a May 7th pledge that of solidarity for the Iraqi Christians. This is before ISIS came in, and for Syrian Christians that I was involved in, and 300 American Christian leaders, some very top leaders, signed that pledge. And they really need to get more active in speaking about what's going on, educating their flocks, and praying, constantly praying for these people who are being martyred right now. You know, we know the names of the first century martyrs, and as Pope Francis has said, there are more martyrs today than in the first century, that the persecution now is more intense than it was in the early Roman Empire. So we really need to be doing far more and also helping them materially, spiritually, and then politically, calling on our elected political officials to help these Christians, maybe bring some here, help them resettle, come up with a plan for resettlement in the region or in Kurdistan, but they need help.
Finally this week, Jerusalem is the center of a global conflict. Christians are called to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And as we leave you with these aerial views of the Holy City, we hope you lift up your prayers for peace. That's all for this edition. I'm Chris Mitchell. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you right here next time on Jerusalem Dateline.